The next item of business is a debate on motion number 14820 in the name of Bruce Crawford on changing relationships, parliamentary scrutiny of intergovernmental relations. Members who wish to take part in the debate should press the request to speak button now. And I call on Bruce Crawford to speak to and move the motion on behalf of the Devolution for the Burghs Committee. Mr Crawford, 14 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, when the report on the Smith Commission was published, I noted the comments of Lord Smith with regard to intergovernmental relations in his foreword to the Commission's report. I did not, however, anticipate that the intergovernmental relations would form such a significant strand of the Devolution Committee's workload. I was wrong. And in that work, I would like to thank the clerks, particularly Stephen Imrie and Stephen Herbert, for all the work that they have contributed to this report. Now, it's worth repeating the comments of Lord Smith at the outset of this debate, where Lord Smith said, throughout the course of the Commission, the issue of weak or intergovernmental working was repeatedly raised as a problem. That current situation, coupled with what will be a stronger Parliament and a more complex devolution settlement, means the problem needs to be fixed. Both governments need to work together to create a more productive, robust, visible and transparent relationship. The need for a more visible and transparent relationship has been a recurring theme in the evidence we have received from the outset of the Committee's consideration of for further devolution. The Committee, in its interim report on the then draft legislative causes, agreed with Lord Smith's view that the currently largely non-statutory machinery governing intergovernmental relations in the UK needs significant reform. We also highlighted that the Committee intended to undertake further work on the issue of how Parliaments can scrutinise the arrangements reached between governments in this sphere. In order to gain a better understanding of this issue, the Committee commissioned external research on how such scrutiny is undertaken in other countries. This academic research was led by Professor Nicola McEwen at the Centre for Constitutional Change, based at the University of Edinburgh. They considered scrutiny in places in a number of countries, including Belgium, Canada, Germany, the USA, Spain and Switzerland. And the research reached two broad conclusions. Firstly, intergovernmental relations, as you would expect, are dominated by governments, with the opportunities for parliaments and parliamentarians to engage in scrutiny of these processes being relatively limited. Secondly, the dominance of governments in this area, it was found that in almost every country examined, parliaments in these countries had a bit more of a role in scrutinising intergovernmental relations than the role of parliaments here in the UK. And I want to thank Professor McEwen, who is also the committee's advisor on intergovernmental relations, as well as Dr. Bettina Peterson and Corey Brown-Swan, for their work in producing an excellent research report in such a short period. Presiding Officer, through the course of taking evidence on parliamentary scrutiny of IGR, we received some fairly depressing messages from our witnesses. I'd like to share some of that evidence with the Chamber. Firstly, in response to a question about whether there were any countries which were a good example of parliamentary scrutiny of IGR, Professor Michael Keating commented, "No, but there are lots of bad examples." Secondly, Professor Bert Maddens from the University of Leuven commented that the issue of intergovernmental relations is so complex and technical that the involvement of politicians in Parliament is doomed to be marginal. That was a good start, wasn't it? But, Presiding Officer, we on the Devolution Committee are made of stern stuff. We were not deterred. I've got some giggling going on behind me here, Presiding Officer. They don't recognise Stern, obviously.
We are not recognise it. Just continue.
When we sought in our report to make a range of recommendations that seek to improve parliamentary scrutiny of IGR. I hope that other members of committees will no doubt want to discuss in more detail the recommendations we unanimously agreed and will be interested in the views of members who do not sit on the Devolution Committee with regards to the suggestions we propose. Before considering the committee's recommendations, I want to stress that the committee's report is called Changing Relationships for a Reason. Without a greater degree of willingness on the part of all governments across the UK to be more open and transparent about intergovernmental working. I say this as a former Cabinet Secretary for Parliamentary Business, then parliamentary scrutiny will not improve. The ruler requires to be a significant culture change on the part of all governments in regard to how they view the role of parliamentarians in this sphere. The Deputy First Minister reflected this perspective in his comments to the committee when he said, "One of my criticisms of the intergovernmental mechanisms is that they've been rather rigid and scripted and not particularly relevant. I hope that we can improve on them." In a similar vein, I believe that we as parliamentarians have to be honest about our role. We need to ask whether we have taken sufficient interest over the 16 years since we were established and how governments work together and what we can do to improve our scrutiny practices. The evidence we received from Professor Aileen McCarg should provide us with food for thought. She commented, "Parliament scrutiny has been one of the areas in which the current system has not worked. Neither the Scottish Parliament nor the UK Parliament has taken any consistent interest in the scrutiny of intergovernmental relations. There have been some ad hoc inquiries, but that is all. In that regard, relationships have to change, both within governments and parliaments, as well as between parliaments and governments. The committee's report seeks to help begin that process of change. We recommend that two guiding principles should inform this process. The new structure of intergovernmental work, which is currently being reformed through work led by the UK Government's Cabinet Office, will be critical to the success or otherwise of the proposals for further devolution. In the committee's view, the impact of IGR will be most critical to the operation of powers in the areas of taxation and the fiscal framework, as well as more generally in the implementation of well-power powers and European decision-making. Accordingly, if this Parliament, and indeed parliaments across the UK, are able to scrutinise the actions of their respective governments, then that new structure of intergovernmental working must be more transparent. This must involve there being transparency around the policy objectives governments are seeking to achieve, the agreements reached between governments, and decisions made. Secondly, these relationships must be accountable. In our view, this means that agreements reached between governments must be subject to scrutiny and clear mechanisms developed for this scrutiny. To enable this to happen, the principles of transparency and accountability must be included in the memorandum of understanding that governs IGR across the UK. In the words of no less a statesman than President Obama herself, a democracy requires accountability, and accountability requires transparency. In order to embed these principles that, in the committee's view, should underpin the operation of IGR from the outset, the committee recommend that these principles of transparency and accountability be placed in statute in the Scotland Bill. The committee recognises that the process of revising the Memorandum of Understanding impacts on all four legislators across the UK. In our view, the Scottish context, we consider that a new written agreement between the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament should be reached. This agreement should cover the detail of the information the Scottish Government would provide the Scottish Parliament with in regard to formal IGR meetings and agreements. Let me be clear, however, what matters here is that relationships change. How that's achieved, whether by placing principles in statute, revising memorandums of understanding, or creating a new written agreement between the Scottish Parliament and Government, will not in itself effect change. What will be required is a significant culture change in relationship between legislators and executives across the UK with regard to transparency around intergovernmental relations. Let me say, Presiding Officer, that we do recognise, however, the need for governments to have a private space in which negotiations can take place and agreements be reached. In that regard, the Devolution Committee respects the need for there not to be a running commentary in relation to the current intergovernmental discussions that are taking place. Nevertheless, we are unanimous in our view that there has to be improved transparency around these processes put in place and we sought to establish a means of how this can be achieved. As I said earlier, changing relationships in this area is not just about governments changing its approach, but critically Parliament also reforming our own scrutiny structures in order to be more effective in this area. In order to improve Parliament's scrutiny of IGR, the Committee recommended that Parliamentary Bureau in the next session of Parliament should give careful consideration to establishing a specific parliamentary committee tasked with scrutinising IGR or providing an existing committee with such a role. The approach of establishing specific committee tasked with scrutinising intergovernmental relations is a common approach amongst Canadian provincial legislators, Belgian regions and communities, and some of the Spanish autonomous parliaments. We recommend that this committee should report to the Parliament on any intergovernmental agreement entered into by the Scottish Government. In addition, such a committee should take evidence from the Scottish Government prior and following formal intergovernmental meetings. Presiding Officer, the decision to form a new committee or to alter the remits of existing committees are not matters for the Devolution Committee to decide. For the Devolution Committee, our role will cease at the end of this parliamentary session. It will be for a new Parliament to consider how best to ensure that appropriate scrutiny mechanisms are put in place. However, the current negotiations that are taking place on a quadrilateral basis regarding the revision of the Memorandum of Understanding and on a bilateral basis regarding the fiscal framework are critically important to the work of the committee. Presiding Officer, I again want to put on record the committee's view that we will require adequate time to scrutinise both these agreements in detail. As we all know, the fiscal framework in particular is absolutely critical to our understanding of the Scotland Bill and its subsequent implementation. In closing, Presiding Officer, I want to conclude my remarks here today by emphasising that the subject of intergovernmental relations may appear to be some, to be, even many, to be obscure, technocratic and of little relevance to the real issues which we all have to deal with as elected representatives. To be honest, I may even share that view myself at the beginning of our considerations, but my view has changed. The proposals in the Scotland Bill for new powers on tax and welfare will make the operation of intergovernmental relations the most critical aspect of the proposed new arrangements. The current negotiations on the fiscal framework provide us with our first indication of that as we shift from a model that's about reserve powers to a shared powers model of devolution. As a Parliament and as parliamentarians, we have to be able to respond to that shift. Presiding Officer, in this vein, I think our ideas make a contribution to the reforms of the Scottish Parliament and its committees that you yourself have championed. Our report was not just about this current parliamentary session. You know, it's also about the experience that we've had as parliamentarians across all four parliamentary sessions since 1999 and how we shape the experience of the future. And all of us here in this Parliament, because of that hinterland, because of that background, can make a significant contribution into the next session of Parliament as new parliamentarians come to this chamber to do their work. Our ideas for reform don't just affect my committee, but all committees. Accordingly, I'll be interested in hearing the views of members from other committees. And I want to thank my fellow committee members very much for agreeing unanimously our view on how that change can take place in the future. And I move the motion in my name.
I now call on John Swinney, Deputy First Minister, 10 minutes.
President Officer, can I begin by thanking the convener of the Devolution for the Powers Committee for the presentation of the committee's report this afternoon. Mr Crawford has served, as he indicated in his speech, as a Cabinet Secretary with responsibility for intergovernmental relations, so I think it's a valuable insight that he brings to this debate through the combination of that experience and also the role as convening the Devolution and Further Powers Committee, which has given such detailed scrutiny to the next stage in the devolution journey by the scrutiny of the Scotland Bill and associated proceedings that have taken place in the course of the last year or so. I'd like to thank the committee for bringing the issue to the chamber today. I've read the committee's report with interest and have already provided an initial response welcoming the recommendations, which I hope the committee found helpful. My perspective on this discussion is largely formed by my experience over the last 8.5 years in being involved in many discussions between ministers in the Scottish Government and the United Kingdom Government on bilateral and multilateral issues, and certainly in relation to my specific responsibilities as the Finance Secretary, I have valued the opportunity through intergovernmental discussions to be able to make representations to the United Kingdom Government in partnership with my colleagues in Wales and Northern Ireland, and actually on certain occasions to be successful in advancing those perspectives which are largely shared between the devolved administrations and in changing the perspective of the United Kingdom Government. My perspective has also been informed by my participation within the Smith Commission, which certainly spent a great deal of time discussing the issues of intergovernmental relations, and the nature of those discussions had such an effect on the proceedings that led Lord Smith to remark, as he did, in his own commentary on the need to improve those relationships and the way in which they operate. This is, and I agree very much with Mr Crawford in this respect, an area that is constantly evolving. The devolution settlement has changed significantly from the contents of the Scotland Act as it was legislated for in 1998, and we must acknowledge the importance of changing the nature of the relationships between the different administrations of the United Kingdom to reflect that changing settlement over the course of now 16 years and 4 parliamentary terms. And Mr Crawford used the term that we were now in a space where we are more habitually sharing powers with the United Kingdom Government. And I think what that brings is a challenging set of issues around intergovernmental relations, because they also involve the necessity of changing mindsets and ways of undertaking intergovernmental business, which may be different to how administrations have been accustomed to exercising those responsibilities. And I confirm on behalf of the Scottish Government today our willingness to be part of addressing how that change in culture and mood may be taken forward. President, officer, the Scottish Government is committed to openness and transparency in our joint working, both bilaterally with the United Kingdom Government and on a wider basis with the United Kingdom Government and other devolved administrations. We are committed also to work with other parties across the chamber to ensure that the Parliament has strong working relationships with our sister institutions across the United Kingdom. And the Government is committed to ensuring this Parliament plays a proper part in both shaping the formal agreements that we enter into and holding us to account for the conduct of business with other administrations. In that respect, I think it is not the proper role of Government, and I've highlighted this in the response to the committee's report, to specify how Parliament should exercise those responsibilities other than to signal the willingness of the Government to respond to the demands of Parliament for effective and transparent scrutiny of this area of activity. Against this backdrop, I can assure the Chamber that the committee's recommendations and the points that will be made in the debate today will be fully taken into account in our discussions on the development of intergovernmental working as we seek to continue to improve the arrangements that prevail. Presiding Officer, I'd like to acknowledge the need for change in these relationships. I'm sure that all members will agree with the conclusions in the Smith Agreement that the additional powers we hope will come to this Parliament as a result of its successful implementation will require change in our intergovernmental machinery. The Scottish Government will play its part in making that happen. We recognise our duty to the people of Scotland to do so, and we hope and expect to see that same approach on the part of the United Kingdom Government. Whilst we are keen to strengthen our working arrangements with the UK Government, we should acknowledge that the formal liaison machinery is based on agreements across all devolved administrations and the UK Government. We are not alone in gearing up for significant change. The Silk Commission, like Smith, called for enhancement of existing mechanisms for improving relations between the Welsh and the UK governments, and the Government of Wales Bill promises significant changes in the Welsh devolution settlement. Our friends in the Northern Ireland Executive face a distinct set of circumstances, of course, and these inevitably shape how they approach this agenda. Our current intergovernmental processes need to be understood against this backdrop. This Parliament quite rightly will wish to see the current liaison arrangement strengthened and to hold the Government to account, and we are clearly moving into substantially more complex territory compared to when the machinery for intergovernmental relations was first established. Our arrangements must evolve with the times, but they must also be negotiated with our partners and to meet our collective interests. Presiding Officer, there are of course clear political differences between the administrations, but through the Edinburgh Agreement we have previously demonstrated how we can put these to one side to enable progress when it is right and necessary to do so. Against that backdrop, I remain hopeful that we will be able to secure the changes that this Parliament will expect to see. I've already referred to the growing complexity of the devolution settlement in Scotland, Presiding Officer. As more powers, especially around tax and welfare, are devolved, so it will be important to ensure seamless joint working across the border to ensure that the different policies and priorities that this Government and this Parliament will pursue in relation to these powers and the different services that are accordingly put in place are implemented and operate effectively alongside continuing services provided by the UK Government. This will put an onus on the Scottish Government to be willing to discuss our proposals and delivery plans openly. I can assure the Chamber that we will do so through the existing liaison machinery and by establishing new arrangements where necessary. We are taking forward some of this work through the Joint Ministerial Committee on Welfare, for example. But this is a two-way street, Presiding Officer. We must see a willingness on the part of the UK to similarly discuss proposals with and be prepared to listen to the alternative perspective of the Scottish Government. There are few, if any, areas of policy where the Scottish Government does not now have a legitimate interest, and our expectation is that our views will be taken into account in that process. Recent events suggest that there is still some way to go before we can be confident that we genuinely have the kind of partnership-based approach and willingness on the part of the UK Government to respond to distinctive Scottish concerns. As the Chamber is aware, the Scotland Bill completed its common stages on the 9th of November and will now be considered by the House of Lords. I would like to acknowledge the work of the committee in scrutinising the Bill. I agree wholeheartedly with the conclusions in the Convener's recent letter to the Secretary of State. I agree there have been improvements made to the Bill, but there are still significant shortfalls in the drafting, which we will continue to press the UK Government to address. The substantive changes we saw at Commons report, devolution of the power to create new benefits, an equalities provision that will allow us to set gender quotas for public boards, and some progress in ensuring the permanence of this Parliament, are in no small measure the result of the representations made by the Government and the Committee. The Scottish Government will continue to work with the UK Government to secure further improvements to the Bill, with the aim of being able to recommend it to Parliament. However, as I and the First Minister have made clear, we will only support a legislative consent motion if there is a satisfactory and fair fiscal framework agreed between the Scottish and United Kingdom governments. To that end, I will continue to meet with the Chief Secretary to the Treasury to discuss the transfer of fiscal levers that will allow this Parliament to responsibly use the new powers promised to us. This will have to be done with consideration to the UK spending review later this month and the subsequent Scottish budget. The governments agreed at the commencement of these discussions that the details of the fiscal framework would not be announced until they are finalised. However, with the aim of creating transparency and accountability where reasonable, topics discussed are published after each particular meeting. Once negotiations are complete, the details of that agreement will be laid before Parliament as a legislative consent memorandum. I recognise, of course, the point made today and previously by the Convener and others about the need for proper parliamentary scrutiny of the fiscal framework, and I commit myself once again to ensuring that Parliament is satisfied by the level of parliamentary scrutiny that we make available to ensure that Parliament can be properly convinced that effective parliamentary scrutiny has been exercised over the discussions which are taking place at intergovernmental level. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, as I noted in my opening remarks, I have provided an initial written response to the committee expressing my broad support for the recommendations contained in its report, subject to us being able to make them work effectively. Consideration of these recommendations will form a key element of the review of the formal intergovernmental machinery commissioned by the Joint Ministerial Committee last December in response to the report of the Smith Commission. The Government is determined to work constructively through the Joint Ministerial Committee review with the objective of ensuring that we have arrangements in place that can enhance intergovernmental working and ensure that Parliament can be satisfied that the effective exercise of parliamentary scrutiny has been applied in this and other cases.
Many thanks. And to now call on Claire Baker, 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I would like to first thank the committee members for their work in producing this report. Our politics and our Parliament are changing. We are about to increase the powers of this Parliament, not just to make decisions alone, but to enter more frequently into relationships of partnership and negotiation with the UK Government. We also need to devolve power and decision-making. New powers coming to Scotland are not the exclusive domain of politicians, government or of this Parliament. Since 1999, there has been a working relationship between the UK and the Scottish Government. And as the report recognises, these were mainly informal and they were founded on good communication, goodwill and mutual trust. There are some examples of how this operated. I am currently a member of the Scottish Government's Working Group on Post-Work Study Visas. The forerunner to this, the Fresh Talent Scheme, was created through a series of negotiations and compromises by the then Scottish Executive and the Home Office. That was an example of intergovernmental relationships in action. However, no one would argue now that the currently largely informal relationships, which we are used to, are capable of addressing the key issues around where policy responsibility overlaps, where there are going to be common challenges, or to prevent or resolve disputes that are fit for current or future governments. The new powers that are coming to this Parliament will require a greater deal of power sharing between two governments and parliaments as well as with the electorate, particularly in the areas of social security and welfare. As Lord Smith identifies, a more productive, robust, visible and transparent set of relationships are required. But we have to guard against creating a further democratic deficit. And while the governments agree a new memorandum of understanding between the UK government and the devolved administrations, we as parliamentarians have to be able to scrutinise decision making. Just because the structures may be more formal, it doesn't mean we necessarily make any progress on what is seen as government to government deals. A brief example of this is the current discussions on the fiscal framework. I do appreciate that these negotiations can be difficult, they may even be delicate, but outside that process, everyone else can only rely on the reporting or the interpretation from each partner. That might be fine when there's agreement, but if there's a conflict, it's difficult for others to form a view of a process that has been exclusive. And even when there is agreement, we are then presented with a done deal which allows for little scrutiny. I do appreciate the Deputy First Minister has recently shared discussions with some members, but I would like to see greater transparency of this process. And as John Swain identifies, it's an area which the committee report has also raised. And I welcome the committee's call for scrutiny of the revised Memorandum of Understanding and the fiscal framework. However, once these processes are finished, the committee does explore how the parliamentary scrutiny can be exercised in intergovernment relationships going forward. It recognises that this is an area we are weak in, identifying that a whole range of policy areas are rarely questioned. And Professor Michael Keating described it as, whenever there is intergovernment working, things disappear into rather opaque areas. We have very poor parliamentary scrutiny of intergovernmental relationships. The committee report is useful in exploring some of the ways in which the Parliament can respond to the challenges it faces when providing scrutiny. The report does consider what kind of information would be required from government for effective scrutiny and sets out a number of options, both statutory and non-statutory. It provides a good basis for consideration of how this Parliament maintains a healthy, open, transparent democracy going forward. The Deputy First Minister's comments on devolution of land and buildings transaction tax in the report are illuminating. Although he outlines a process between officials, the Deputy First Minister said, ultimately, however, the resolution came down to a 15-minute conversation between the Chief Secretary to the Treasury and me. Such questions will be resolved politically by ministers as long as there is willingness to do that. So greater parliamentary scrutiny will not necessarily change that kind of situation. The European and the international examples in the report may show greater parliamentary scrutiny of government relationships, including providing mandates for positions, but it appears to remain that these are ultimately executive decisions. Even Belgium, where parliaments can have a more formal role with the capacity to reject or accept, that role is still seen as very limited. There is clearly a difficult and complex balance to be struck to determine the level of parliament influence or involvement or even knowledge in the negotiation between two governments. But as Bruce Crawford said, we shouldn't be deterred. Scotland is so far behind our other European partners, and we are starting from such a low point of engagement that there is space for us to develop greater scrutiny and transparency. Clearly, we need to consider the most effective way of achieving this, and the committee considers three options: entire Parliament debates on agreements, a specific parliamentary committee that could scrutinise the relationships, and mainstreaming scrutiny across different subject committees across the Parliament. However, the report recognises that there needs to be relevant information shared and political incentive, and there must be the will to undertake scrutiny to make it effective and to have a purpose. It is as much up to us as a parliament as it is up to the government to respond to these challenges and maintain our status as a transparent and open parliament. Presiding officer, yesterday I took part in a Futures Forum discussion led by SCVO and What Works Scotland. We considered the potential for participatory budgeting and greater involvement in national decision-making. We often reflect in here that the past year or so in politics has enlivened and generated political awareness and debate in our country. How we effectively scrutinise the future of intergovernment relationships is part of this agenda. The new powers coming to the Parliament will bring new challenges. We may have a more engaged electorate, and we should involve people in the debate and understanding of these new powers. The report is right to say that the role of legislatures in scrutinising these relationships will be critical to the public understanding of the proposals for further devolution. And in reflecting on international examples, the committee say increased scrutiny of intergovernmental relationships was considered as being beneficial in terms of raising public awareness of and debate regarding intergovernmental decision making. Let us ensure that this Parliament matures both in the extent of our powers and our relationship with the UK Government and Parliament, and that we develop high standards of transparency, scrutiny and public engagement.
Many thanks. And now call on Annabel Goldie. 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. This may not seem the juiciest morsel which this chamber has ever delighted in chewing over, but as is often the case with plain fare, it matters. Not that I would ever describe Mr. Swinney or Mr. Crawford as plain fare. So I thank the devolution further. A sedentary intervention here. Can I thank the Devolution Further Powers Committee for their hard work and also for the recent report enabling this debate to take place, because it is important. I want to focus my remarks on the arena of intergovernmental relationships. I think this matters because without some framework to structure that engagement between Westminster and the devolved governances, in our case Westminster and the Scottish Government, then I think both are the poorer. And it seems to me that the framework should be both sufficiently robust and resilient that it accommodates administrations of different political beliefs. Indeed, I think that's almost a default test by which it should be measured, an ethos not dissimilar to the civil service. Now, I'm not going to dwell on what has happened over the last 16 years, other than to observe the framework seems to have operated spasmodically. And I think the starting point for this debate should be the Smith Agreement and the Devolution Further Powers Committee report of 6 October of this year. As members will know, I was a member of the Smith Commission, and interestingly, I thought that commission was itself a good model of how people with very different political perspectives can actually have intelligent, informed and respectful discussions. And indeed, I think the Commission got to the heart of the matter when it stated, and Mr. Crawford has already referred to this, and I quote from the Commission document. It said, throughout the course of the Commission, the issue of weak intergovernmental working was repeatedly raised as a problem, not by the members, but by those making submissions to us. It also went on to say that current situation, coupled with what will be a stronger Scottish Parliament and a more complex devolution settlement, means a problem needs to be fixed. And it finally said, both governments need to work together to create a more productive, robust, visible and transparent relationship, and there also needs to be greater respect between them. And Lord Smith of Kelvin, when recently stating that the Scotland Bill honoured the Smith Agreement, commented on intergovernmental relations because he said, and I quote, "It's never been good enough. There's really a lot more that could be done here." He went on to say that what was needed was, and again I quote, "at government level, ministerial level, respecting each other." Now, I thought, to be fair, Mr. Swinney's contribution this afternoon was very encouraging in that respect, because basically what we have at present is the Memorandum of Understanding, which since 1999 has been the written underpinning of intergovernmental relations in the UK, between UK and all the devolved administrations. And its current version was agreed in 2013. We also have the Joint Ministerial Committees. Now, that Memorandum of Understanding is currently the subject of a quadrilateral review, not just between us and the UK government, but involving the other administrations as well. And I'm not going to detail, Deputy Presiding Officer, the existing structures and their bodies, but there are various quadrilateral groups and some bilateral groups comprising just the UK and Scotland. Because what I think is important is not so much as what is there at the moment, but before we contemplate specific proposals or changes, we should be clear about what purpose this intergovernmental dialogue is meant to serve. Now, I think it should be two-way, and within the UK it will sometimes be a four-way flow of information. For example, I think the Scottish Government is entitled to know if Westminster proposes change which affects Scotland, what are these changes? And in turn, the Scottish Government should be able to feed in its response, its suggestions or its counter-proposals. And there needs to be a framework and a process to facilitate that. Now, importantly, the Scottish Government may be able to contribute research data, information, experience in relation to a variety of policy areas and government responsibilities which may positively inform Westminster. Likewise, Westminster may be able to do the same, but that all needs a transparent, visible structure. Where we need to strike a balance, I think, is ensuring that the structure serves an identified purpose and is not just a cosmetic box-ticking exercise. Both Westminster and Scottish Government ministers are busy with their own responsibilities. We must avoid them being distracted by the process and ensure their involvement is to add value to the process. Now, some debate has ranged over the formal versus the informal, the statutory versus the non-statutory. And I thought John Swinney made an insightful contribution to the committee. He pointed out with some authority that structures can have their place, but his particular experience with reference to the land and building transaction tax arrangements ultimately depended on a resolution arising from a 15-minute conversation between himself and the Chief Secretary to the Treasury. And I think that illustrates that we need both the formal and the informal. The nature of politics is that politicians can actually strike up relationships with other parties, with other governments. Yes, Mr. Swinney.
Deputy First Minister.
I'm grateful to Scotland for giving way, and I think her citing of that example is instructive about the importance of there being a willingness to try to find some basis of understanding the motivations and the concerns that will be in the minds of both the devolved administration in trying to advance its arguments and to have those heard by the UK government.
Annabel Goldie.
Yes, I wouldn't disagree with that, Mr. Swinney, and I think that is why it is so important, as we contemplate significant new powers, that we begin to open up these avenues of dialogue. And we do that, as Lord Smith himself has said, within an umbrella of mutual respect. While there's universal recognition that we need to improve intergovernmental relationships, improve the flow of information, create a visible structure, there is still a journey to travel to develop the source, the shape of this structure, rather. And can I just conclude, Presiding Officer, by saying I have two anxieties about the statutory road. The first is a practical one, because I don't think we've got a coherent shape at present we could commit to statute. And, of course, it's not just England, it's not just rather Scotland, the UK, it's also England, Wales and Northern Ireland. Secondly, perhaps more importantly, resilience and flexibility are not the realm of statute. And I remember learning that lesson clearly as a law student when I studied constitutional law. So I would counsel caution before going down that road. But I do think the committee has identified five useful areas to investigate, and I hope we can take forward these discussions in a constructive manner.
Many thanks. We now turn to the open debate. Speeches of 6 minutes, please. There is not a lot of time in hand. I call Mark MacDonald, to be followed by Malcolm Chisholm.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And has already been stated by more than one speaker today that, on the face of it, what we're debating today is very technocratic, very dry, all about process. But process is important, particularly when it comes to looking at the devolution process and the underpinnings of that. And I think we're entering a critical phase in relation to intergovernmental relations, because as the Deputy First Minister outlined, many powers will now operate on a shared basis, and we will enter, I think, a much more complex series of interactions between governments being required compared to previous years during the devolution process. I think that certainly will be true in terms of how financial decision-making takes place in relation to the fiscal framework and in relation to how money is allocated to this Parliament beyond that which we will be responsible for raising. And that has raised some questions from the committee's perspective around how to scrutinise in these areas. And I think there have been some difficulties for the committee in that process. I think the first, from having read Nicola McEwen's paper and also from the committee report, would be that there are a lack of directly analogous examples out there, as evidenced by the submissions we received and the research we commissioned. And I think that bears out in terms of looking for an example that could be lifted and applied to Scotland, that in some respects that presents a challenge because, as the convener noted from Michael Keating's evidence, there are plenty bad examples out there, but he couldn't identify a good example. But at the same time, I think that also presents an opportunity which I'll come back to. But the other challenge I think it presents is that a lot of the evidence that we received and that we took was that when looking at other areas where intergovernmental relations were being examined, intergovernmental relations can often be tokenistic, and there was a feeling that the mechanisms to facilitate them were often flimsy and could be very easily and very readily disregarded by often by the central or federal government, depending on the example we were exploring. And that tended to be a consistent theme, I think, of the evidence that the committee was taking. So there will be a need, I think, to guard against that. To that end, I think the committee has sought to try and balance the need for discussions to be able to take place with a degree of confidentiality, as I think we would accept that there does need to be a degree of confidentiality that around some discussions that take place between governments, but at the same time an expectation that Parliament should be able to take more of a role in scrutinising the discussions, the outcomes, and I think most importantly the impact of those outcomes on the ability of this Parliament to deliver policy and to operate within its financial capabilities. The other opportunity element, I think, Presiding Officer, is that alongside the difficulty that we face in not having a directly analogous example that we could lift and supplant into Scotland, it presents us with an opportunity, I think, to develop our own model and to develop a unique model, and one that perhaps avoids some of the difficulties and pitfalls that have been faced in other areas and allows us perhaps to shape something a little bit more dynamic in that respect. But I think the other difficulty that the committee has faced is that often during our deliberations, during our discussions, there has been a lack of clarity and a lack of definition around what exactly it is that is to be scrutinised. Because intergovernmental relations in and of itself covers, I think, a multitude of areas, a multitude of discussions taking place between governments. And I think what the committee has tried to wrestle with is to get a clearer understanding of what it is that is to be scrutinised and then how best that can be scrutinised. So I think there is still work to be done in that respect, and it will be interesting. I think we've had a response from the Scottish Government outlining its thoughts on the matter. In terms of the UK Government position, it seems to be a case of we're currently thinking about this in relation to the overall UK devolution framework. That, I think, we'll need to see a little bit more of the thinking of the UK government, because obviously there's more than one player in these discussions. But that will be a challenge, I think, to those who are tasked with the role of scrutiny should the recommendation of either a new committee or an expanded remit of an existing committee be taken forward by Parliament. That will be something that will need to be examined there. And I think the first key challenge in this will be around the fiscal framework. There is undoubtedly a need to protect the confidentiality of negotiating positions in relation to the fiscal framework and ensure that those discussions can take place. But I think the Deputy First Minister has been very clear to committees of this Parliament and to the Chamber of this Parliament that Parliament will have a role in scrutinising. And I think it is on that scrutiny and the analysis that will take place that much of what we are discussing today is going to either stand or fall.
Many thanks. I now call Malcolm Chisholm to be followed by Rob Gibson.
Presiding Officer, I think it's fair to say that inter-government relations have been important ever since the advent of devolution, but that they're about to get a whole lot more important, particularly with the new tax and social security powers that are coming to this Parliament. Now, of course, this was recognised by Lord Smith in the course of his commission, and in a sense, the starting point for today's debate is the words that he said that have been quoted already, that the issue of weak intergovernment relations was repeatedly raised as a problem, he said. And of course, the fundamental answer to that, as Bruce Crawford emphasised, is culture change on the part of both governments. But I thought Bruce Crawford also made a very interesting point that we need to take more interest in this as well as parliamentarians, because I have to say I agree with Annabel Goldie. I've never regarded this as a particularly juicy morsel, and in fact I have to make the shocking confession that I'm speaking in this debate out of a sense of duty rather than pleasure. Now, it may be that's because I was immersed in the bad old ways as a minister, although there was much useful relationships between governments in those days. I remember, for example, meetings we used to have of all the health ministers in the four UK countries. Although we had very different health systems, those meetings were very useful, and that's just one example. But I suppose I was more surprised when Ken Thompson, who the lead civil servant on these matters, came to our committee and said that even now it's the informal meetings between officials and ministers that really matter. I mean, I suppose I should have been pleased about that the ministers are still having those meetings. Of course, it was much easier in the old days when you had ministers of the same party here and in the UK Parliament. In fact, interestingly, in the external research that's been referred to by Nicola McEwen and others, they pointed out that, in fact, it's very common in European countries to have informal networks within political parties when those operate at the central and sub-state level. So that's really what we're trying to move beyond, although there's no harm in that, of course, in itself. I'll give way.
Stuart Stevenson.
Briefly and actually seriously, isn't it more difficult to disagree with colleagues than opponents?
Malcolm
Chisholm. Well, I certainly disagreed with the Health Minister, English Health Minister, on many occasions. Now, of course, Nicola McEwen's research came up with two central conclusions. I think there were lots of detail. Firstly, that other countries' intergovernment relations are also dominated by the executives, but also crucial that every country examined allowed Parliament a greater role in scrutiny. So that's the challenge for us. Three forms of scrutiny were highlighted still in the research, debates in the whole Parliament, specific committees are mainstreaming with all the committees, and the external research identified five key issues for consideration: timing and access for information, setting up a committee, hearings at evidence sessions, consent votes by the whole Parliament, which haven't come up very much today, but I think that's particularly going to be important with the fiscal framework, and also transparency. And of course, it was the principles of transparency and accountability that were up very much in flashing lights for the committee as their central recommendation. And in fact, they recommended that it should be in statute. And that can't happen now unless Baroness Goldie will go down to the House of Lords and move an amendment that the principles of transparency and accountability should be in statute. There were several other recommendations in the report, mainly for the government, but of course two that weren't for the government. And we can't really be quite so firm in our recommendations when it's only to the Parliament, but we did suggest that the Parliament should give careful consideration we weren't so gentle with the government. Careful consideration to a special committee, so I'm sure the Parliament will, but also interestingly said there should be greater inter-parliament cooperation would be useful as well. Again, when I was convener of the European Committee, we had useful meetings of all the European committees of the four nations. I don't know if that still happens, but that's an important suggestion as well. But the harder recommendations clearly are for government. So the next two are central, that there should be a written agreement on the oversight of intergovernment relations, and that would provide the detail, obviously, of information, detail of how information and what information should be given and how the views of Parliament should be incorporated, but also, crucially, that scrutiny should happen before intergovernment meetings as well as afterwards, probably in the form of taking evidence from the government. And that may be harder for the government to accept, but Michael Keating said all the arguments about not showing your hand or about confidentiality are just special pleading by governments that do not want to be held accountable. So the immediate issues, of course, we have before us are the fiscal framework and the memorandum of understanding. I've already said I hope there will be a vote of the whole Parliament on the fiscal framework, but also I hope the government will consult us on that before it's formally agreed. I can see there will have to be an interim agreement, but it shouldn't be formally agreed, we are saying, until the Parliament has been involved. And also, there must be adequate time for scrutinising the memorandum of understanding as well. And that's crucial. We're saying there must be a specific section in the memorandum of understanding on parliamentary oversight. But unfortunately, it seems that old habits die hard, and Professor Aileen McCarg, last quote I've got time for, said, once again, it's being treated as a matter for negotiation between officials rather than something in which there is legitimate parliamentary and public concern. So we haven't really moved forward any distance at all in the last 16 years. So I think this is an important report which is actually saying now is the time to take a significant step forward. And having spoken for 6 minutes, I've actually become quite interested in this subject, so I'll follow it with interest.
Many thanks. Before we move on, could I ask members just to check they've pressed the request to speak buttons if they're intending to speak in the debate. Thank you. Rob Gibson, to be followed by Tavish Scott.
Well, thank you, Presiding Officer. I think that we all understand from each of the speeches we've heard so far that the powers promised through the New Scotland Bill are increased and indeed far more complex. So therefore, the question of scrutiny of the processes and the relationships between our two governments and indeed with the four governments within the family of nations of the United Kingdom is all the more critical. If each member is to prosper and if each of the governments is to feel that they're being dealt with fairly. The partial devolution of the Crown Estate assets to Scotland is an example which contains certain vetoes, particularly by the Secretary of State for Defence. So the discussions about a memorandum of understanding which contains these powers of the Ministry of Defence to overrule Scottish policies is one where delicate discussion will have to take place if the name of national security is to be upheld and to be believed by people, then the practical implications of this have got to be discussed at a local level too. And I'll give you an example of this just now to show why it's essential. Last week at Caoimhe Na Cailleadh, my colleague Ian Blackford MP, who represents both Skye and Applecross in his and Dave Thompson's constituency and in mine on the Applecross side, met with the MOD with regard to proposals to quadruple the size of the torpedo range there. He was accompanied by local fishermen. They were seeking a change of behaviour in the way that the MOD behaved. And in the Scottish National Marine Plan, a single framework for managing our seas, it says the MOD can use exemptions in planning law for purposes of national security, and to retain a statutory right to close areas in internal waters and create bylaws to complete closures and exclusions. Well, in this day and age, if these kinds of powers are going to be adopted and continued, then we're going to have to change the way in which we discuss them, because of these 70 fishermen, it's possible that much of their livelihood, especially in winter, could be destroyed if this decision was taken forward. And what was agreed at that meeting was actually to get the Ministry of Defence to consult over a period of time, but to do what the Scottish Government does in any proposals, to consult people about the social and economic impacts of the way in which decisions of government are taken. Now, this is complicated by the fact that it's not a matter of the Scottish Government which is closing these waters, but the UK Secretary for Defence. So therefore, in the event, the MOD has agreed partially to change its behaviour rather than to make the decision by diktat. So this is an indication to me that when we're approaching the questions of intergovernmental relations, we'll be looking for the kind of openness that allows for these kind of issues to be carried forward at a decision-making level, which the government of Scotland has a part in, and so on. So the Defence Secretary has an absolute power over certain of Scotland's assets, air, sea and land. But it's important now that those kind of discussions can take place between the relevant Scottish Ministry and the Ministry of Defence to see that Scotland's fishermen, in this case, are not materially affected by this arbitrary decision. When Enoch Powell said that power devolved is power retained, that was an indication of the way in which the UK saw the partial devolution of powers back in the 1970s when it was discussing things then. Intergovernmental relations, on the other hand, must develop from that truism of Enoch Powell's and develop the kind of transparency and democratic scrutiny that actually treats people as equals and as partners and not as the ruled and the rulers. And that's why this intergovernmental relationship example that I've given suggests that when we pass the draft statutory instruments about the Crown Estate transfer, for example, are passed, that the vetoes which the Minister of Defence has over parts of these assets are things which will have to be discussed in this Parliament before the decisions are taken by this Parliament as a whole about whether we accept the terms of that. And that's why I believe it's essential for us to treat this subject as more than a mere dry constitution making. This affects people's lives and jobs, and that's why it's so important that we get it right. And that's why I raised this example today. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Many thanks. I now call Tavish Scott to be followed by Stuart McMillan.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. To paraphrase Annabel Goldie, the subject of intergovernmental relations is hardly a whirlwind of excitement, although to describe John Swinney and Bruce Crawford as tasty morsels certainly brought a certain frisson to this afternoon's proceedings. The convener confirmed that he hardly saw this as a political whirlwind either in the early discussions in the committee, but I suppose Duncan McNeill and I take a bit of credit, if that's right the word, for boring our colleagues into submission on this one. But it does matter because, and the Deputy First Minister mentioned it, the discussions in Smith were underpinned all the way through by actually how governments just talk to each other, how they respect each other, and how they relate to each other. I noticed at the start of the debate there were 23 members in this chamber, of which 11 were either current or former ministers. There's a smattering across all the benches. Now, probably the ones who should speak are not the ministers, because those of us, and Malcolm Chisholm was quite open about this, those of us who have done that job probably remember some of the tricks of the trade, although, of course, the current ministers wouldn't possibly use such mechanisms to stop Parliament seeing what's going on. But the reality of it, and Ken Thompson, Philip Rycroft, in the most illuminating evidence that the committee had of any, were quite open about that. Both, I respect both men very considerably. They're both very able civil servants. But they both effectively said that what was in place in a parliamentary sense, and not that they were trying, as the Minister rightly did not that they were trying to say how Parliament should scrutinise these things, but they were effectively saying that what's there is fine. And I think as the committee has gone into some detail on this, it's not fine, because as the Deputy First Minister rightly said, the whole thing is changing and evolving. And no better example of that than the financial system that will allow the Scottish Government, the UK, Wales and Northern Ireland to deliver on their policies and programmes within the resources available. Now, we will, as a Parliament at some stage, deal with the fiscal framework, but the point that Duncan McNeill consistently makes in committee, and he's right to, and I agree with him on this, is that the fiscal framework in many ways is the striking current example of whether we have begun to even think about how Parliament scrutinises adequately Mr Swinney's deliberations with his colleagues in different jurisdictions and in this context in the UK government. Now, it is a bit messy. Mr Crawford was absolutely right. Ministers, of course, have to have the space with which to consider these issues. But we've, as a Parliament, got to think about the way in which we do this, because we have, and I think Malcolm Chisholm illustrated this, taken a pretty transient view to how governments talk to each other since 1999. And it hasn't worked as openly and as accountably as we as a committee are now asking that it needs to do. Lord Smith on ITV's Borders, representing Border, said last week, I hope I've got the words roughly right, governments must cooperate, they must make IGR work in good spirit, and I also think he said they need to keep doing that for years and years to come. Now that, I believe, is so. He said, incidentally, some other things about decentralising power within Scotland, which I was very attracted to, but I'll leave that for today. But why this matters is because of the point that the Deputy First Minister made in his remarks, that we are now in substantially more complex territory. That is true, but it's even more so true, not just because of what's happening between Edinburgh and Cardiff and Belfast, and indeed Edinburgh, but what's also happening in Manchester, Newcastle, Liverpool, or the West Country of England. The IPPR, that august research organisation, produced a report this week on empowering counties. Now, I know it's not a lot of interest in this place, but I'm just arguing it should be, because things are starting to change and happen in England, which I think in time will lead to fundamental changes for the UK as a whole. Now, I'm not naive enough to think that we're suddenly about to have a quasi-federal UK, much as I think that is the intellectual answer to most of the challenges that day-to-day we deal with. But nevertheless, because of the changes that are now happening south of the border, and it's very important that that's not driven by centralised government in Whitehall, but driven by a process from beneath. I believe there are some profound changes that will happen across the country as a whole. Just 2 seconds. And that will lead to the point that the Deputy First Minister made, which is that this is a messy process, having to be constantly evolving and indeed refined. Happy to give
Stuart
way.
Stuart Stevenson.
I wonder if the word beneath is itself perhaps an issue. It's perhaps more about co-decision making rather than the hierarchy of decision making.
Tavi Scott.
Stephen might understand that I was describing what I think is going on in England at this time, although Sutton Scottish local government might take his point as well on beneath, and I think we all, if we put aside politics at the moment, in the context of the kind of changes we believe are right for Scotland, I think that's a fair point about the relationship between central and local government in Scotland as well. Two final points, if I may, Deputy Presiding Officer. The first is on the new Prime Minister of Canada, who obviously was could have been the star in at the G20 in Turkey over the weekend, but obviously was not because of what has happened in Paris. But some very interesting things happening in Canada now because of the very different kind of administration he is leading compared to the Harper government of the last 10 years in terms of the provincial and federal relationship. And I just think that's worth looking at. And finally, the point I just wanted to finish with, because I thought it was a good indication that some things are clearly moving in the right direction. In the First Minister's statement just an hour or so ago about Paris, she mentioned that she had been involved in COBRA meetings over the weekend. I took that to be a very appropriate and good sign that the Scotland's First Minister, and I presume others as well, were involved in a meeting involving, I presume, the Prime Minister, although it may have been the Home Secretary, given the Prime Minister's absence overseas, in what must have been fundamentally important discussions and continue to be so. That is an illustration, is it not, that some work that we have all played a small part in is showing some fruits of improvement. That is the challenge that we all have, both and particularly in a parliamentary context.
Many thanks. I now call Stuart McMillan, to be followed by Lewis MacDonald.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Intergovernmental relations are essential to all political systems with multi-level governments, and that's something that, that's been a message that's come across strongly today. And they do come in various forms, as our report and also the paper commissioned by our committee certainly indicates. But one thing is clear, however, that there is no panacea for intergovernmental relations in existence. Indeed, to quote the convener of the committee, if we, which we are all made of sterner stuff, if we can actually use that sterner stuff to actually help create something, then it could be groundbreaking and also world-leading in terms of IGR. IGR does involve the interplay of high politics, which is particularly charged if, or I'm sure as we all agree, if governments involved are of different and competing parties. Inevitably, the high politics plays a major role, but underlying interests of particular units of government often mean that their approach to IGR processes remains similar over time, even as some governments may change. And we must ensure, therefore, that all aspects of IGR are taken with the benefit of the nation and not merely reflections of party politics. And the Smith Commission called for existing intergovernmental machinery to be reformed as a matter of urgency to enable more effective collaboration between the Scottish and the UK governments. However, academics have suggested that the effective intergovernmental relations require a basic level of equality and status between the participants to be effective. And for example, Professor Nicola McCune is quoted in the Herald of earlier this year. She said that unless joint working can be conducted on the basis of equality of status and mutual respect, the complexities of interdependencies are likely to create new sources of tension and dissatisfaction and lead to growing pressure for a further revision of the devolution settlement. Now, the complexity of the new funding model as a result of the Scotland Bill, it means that there is a fundamental need for as much transparency as possible. And that the sad and shocking events in Paris last Friday night highlight the importance of security, particularly in this matter. And in his response to a report, the Deputy First Minister highlighted that providing some information in relation to the British Irish Council would be impossible to publish due to security requirements. And this is something that I'm sure that we can all agree on across the chamber. No one wants to place others in harm's way. Now, a second point regarding IGR that's crucial in progressing improved working relationships is that concerning the Scottish Block Grant. The Block Grant will change as a result of the tax changes proposed in the Scotland Bill. And the whole financial framework underpinning the Scotland Bill is crucial to the progress of this bill, as has been indicated. Discussions on the financial framework are still underway, and it's not yet clear, however, how the adjustment to the Block Grant will take place. The Royal Society of Edinburgh and the British Academy identified a number of issues around Barnet, which they considered required clarification, however, including how reductions in the Block Grant will be determined. They're quoted as saying, "It is, in our opinion, essential to the enduring character of the settlement that the future of the Block Grant is fully resolved." And they continue by saying that this must take into account the nature and scope of new devolved powers, the ongoing mechanism for calculation of changes to the Block Grant related to the no detriment proposition, and the way in which decisions by either government will be reflected in future changes to the grant. Also on the future of the Barnet formula and in clarity around its operation, Professor Michael Keating commented, "It's difficult to see how you can talk about assigning and devolving taxes to Scotland and then not look at the other side of the equation, which is how the Barnet formula works out. That is a matter of principle, but it's also very important when you work out the details, because there is a lot of money involved there. Now, there are a lot of questions simply unanswered about how Barnet is going to work in the future and how the income tax base is going to be calculated in a federal system. Normally, you would have some place where there is a trusted source of calculations, and you may not agree on the policies, but at least you will agree about the basic facts and the basic statistics." Professor Keating said that when he was giving evidence in the House of Commons. But another element of this is the situation regarding the principle of no detriment. This principle is outlined in the Smith Commission report, and that was regarding the exercise of the new powers for Scotland should cause no detriment to the UK as a whole, nor to any of its constituent parts. Now, the principle loves this too applications, which has been discussed on many occasions, certainly in this Parliament, that the Scottish Government and UK Government budgets should be unchanged as a result of the decision to devolve further powers to the Scottish Parliament, and that there should be no detriment as a result of UK Government or Scottish Government policy decisions post-devolution. Arguably, the first application of the no detriment principle is straightforward in that it applies at the point of power when it is devolved. However, the second application is potentially more problematic, as it would apply on an ongoing basis to all policy decisions which affect tax receipts or expenditure. Professor Keating highlighted some concerns about the no detriment principle. Writing for the Centre on Constitutional Change, he stated, while fair in principle, it is a minefield. Now, he further stated that determining what should count as detriment will remain politically contentious and technically complex, and in the evidence to the House of Commons Committee, he explained that the notion of detriment, which is a novel constitutional idea, the idea that if one parliament does something that imposes a cost on another parliament, there should be compensation, potentially should be a very wide-ranging indeed. It is nowhere defined and it is nowhere limited. In conclusion, presiding officer, the effectiveness of parliamentary scrutiny of IGR will depend in part on its ability to be informed on the subject matter, timetable for the discussions and also the goodwill between the governments. I do welcome today's debate and I do hope it assists in the delivery of an improved set of working arrangements between the four governments in the UK, as well as between this Parliament and the Scottish Government. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I now call Lewis MacDonald to be followed by Stuart Maxwell.
Thank you very much. At present, systematic and sustained parliamentary scrutiny of intergovernmental relations by legislatures in the United Kingdom is notable by its absence. That comment from the committee's report neatly summarises where we are now, and the democratic deficit that is an unintended consequence of the evolution of devolved governments and parliaments in the United Kingdom. This committee report is welcome in looking at the experience of the Scottish Parliament and the accountability of the Scottish Government, not just in one wider context, but in two. First, in the context of the devolution of executive powers and legislative responsibilities to three of the four countries of the United Kingdom since 1997, Scotland's experience of devolution may be unique, but it does not stand alone. And second, by seeking to learn lessons from a number of other countries in Europe and North America where powers are shared between different tiers of central government and similar issues of scrutiny and accountability also arise. The growth in responsibilities of this Parliament has not been accompanied by a growth in accountability of Scottish ministers, at least not as far as their engagement with the UK government or with the devolved administrations of Wales and Northern Ireland is concerned. And as has been said, that issue becomes all the more important now because of the Smith Agreement and the New Scotland Bill. I served on the Devolution Committee when the Smith Agreement was signed and when it came to the Committee for Scrutiny. And I think all members agreed that the new devolved and shared powers demanded a new machinery of scrutiny and accountability. What is there now is not fit for purpose. As the committee's interim report on new powers concluded, reforming that system is the most urgent challenge to be addressed in implementing the Smith Commission recommendations. It is significant that the need for increased scrutiny is felt at Westminster as well as here. I gave evidence a year ago to the Political and Constitutional Reform Committee of the House of Commons as MPs sought to understand the implications of change in Scotland for the wider UK. Philip Rycroft of the UK Cabinet Office has predicted that there will be increased scrutiny on intergovernmental relations in the months and years ahead from relevant committees of both the Commons and the Lords. And I have no doubt that he is right about that. And that desire for increased scrutiny will not just apply to the engagement between Scottish and UK ministers. Devolution in Wales and Northern Ireland is also, as John Swinney said, a dynamic process, and its success also depends on the engagement between devolved and union governments. Scrutiny will be vital there too, and as we have also heard this afternoon, devolution of greater powers and responsibilities to cities and other authorities within England will also raise similar issues there as well. The potential mechanisms for increased scrutiny are summed up neatly in the external research which the committee commissioned from Professor Nicola McEwen and her colleagues at Edinburgh University Centre for Constitutional Change. Some of those prospective mechanisms are built on structures or approaches which are already in place, publishing minutes, debating outcomes in Parliament, calling ministers to account for agreements made or not made with other administrations. But others, I think, will require further debate. The formal role of legislators in endorsing or rejecting intergovernmental agreements placed before them by the executives, and whether or not a legislature should have a dedicated committee for dealing with such issues and with constitutional issues more generally. The Constitution Committee of the House of Lords summed up what is needed in terms quoted directly in this report. Effective scrutiny of intergovernmental relations requires both greater transparency than currently exists and the necessary structures and desire in Parliament and the devolved legislatures to scrutinise those relationships. The Devolution Committee, I think, was right to endorse that summary, because this is not only a matter of structures or even of openness, although it is important to get both of those right, it is also a matter of political will. The desire for scrutiny has to be there, as well as the means for achieving it. The best institutional arrangements in the world will count for nothing if a majority in the legislature sees their right to scrutiny as simply another way to endorse the decisions of the executive. Relations between governments must necessarily involve decisions on policy, agreements and disagreements, disputes and compromises. Effective scrutiny will be measured by how often ministers in the respective governments are really held to account for things they do or fail to do in those negotiations. The limitations of structural reform alone are well brought out in the evidence gathered by the committee and the research reported by Professor McEwen. The Belgian example has already been quoted. Belgium has highly devolved structures of government. Scrutiny of intergovernment relations is on a statutory basis, and the Belgian Parliament has a formal role in accepting or rejecting intergovernmental agreements. Yet Professor Maddens of the University of Leuven is quoted as saying that he does not know of any instance where Parliament has ever disagreed with an intergovernmental agreement, while the disengagement of sub-state legislatures from the centre tends to result in a lack of political will to scrutinise intergovernmental relations. That, in turn, creates what he describes as Belgium's democratic deficit. So statutory requirements for scrutiny and transparent processes are not enough on their own. Just as sharing and decentralising power can only work if we want them to, so effective parliamentary scrutiny of intergovernmental relations requires all parties to sign up to make it work. Of course.
Stuart Stevenson.
Just thinking about Parliament's agreeing or disagreeing with international agreements the government's negotiated, I wonder if when Ireland voted against one of the European treaties, and it escapes me which one, whether that was an example of that, and there are one or two others, particularly in European domains, where what Tavish Scott described as the bottom has disagreed with the top, to good effect, perhaps.
Lewis MacDonald, you must begin to conclude.
Well, indeed, the point is well made that parliaments can indeed pass judgment and do so in a way that's effective. I think my point is that simply having the institutional machinery there is not enough in itself. We should welcome this report, but recognise that it is work in progress rather than a final plan for future scrutiny. Like devolution itself, parliamentary scrutiny of intergovernmental relations can work if we want it to, but in the final analysis, its success will be down to political will.
Many thanks. I now call Stuart Maxwell, to be followed by Stuart Stevenson.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. As we've heard, the Devolution Committee has dedicated a considerable part of its work programme to the issue of intergovernmental relations. Although I suspect that the finer details of the processes of intergovernmental relations is unlikely to spark passionate debate in homes, pubs and cafes across the country, it's an important issue nonetheless, and one I am pleased to have the opportunity to discuss today. Now, the conclusions outlined in the committee's report draw from an extensive evidence base. The research undertaken by Professor McEwen and our colleagues at the Centre for Constitutional Change has been very useful indeed in informing the committee's work on the complex issue of IGR, as has the written and oral evidence provided by a range of international experts. Now, the committee has undertaken to learn from the processes and principles that underpin the scrutiny of IGR in other jurisdictions. The research on international comparators suggests that there are limited opportunities for effective scrutiny of IGR by parliaments. However, the report also highlighted that the level of scrutiny in the majority of other countries is significantly greater than that in the UK currently, therefore demonstrating that there is indeed room for improvement from a UK perspective. Now, this has been a recurring theme in the evidence and was also recognised in Lord Smith's report
as an area needing substantial reform, especially as the further devolution of powers will create a number of overlapping areas of responsibility, as a number of other members have already indicated. Of course, we need to remember that the whole point of devolution is to allow different administrations to pursue different policies. In evidence to the House of Lords Select Committee on the Constitution, Professor Michael Keating of the University of Aberdeen made the point that not everything has to be joined up, and good IGR should mean differences in policy being made through the active choices of government, rather than due to lack of consultation or communication. The Scottish Government has been working in conjunction with the UK Government to improve the Scotland Bill and ensure that the Smith Commission recommendations are delivered in full. However, there are still a number of areas where the Bill falls short, including improving transparency in IGR. Now, the Committee made clear in its letter last week to the Secretary of State that there is still work to be done, and I would strongly urge the UK Government to pay careful attention to the conclusions outlined in the Committee's report as the Bill progresses to its final stages. Now, during the committee's oral evidence session in September, my colleague Linda Fabiani made an interesting point about how poorly the joint ministerial committees have served Scotland in the past, with issues concerning Scotland previously categorised under the heading of any other competent business. Perhaps we should be grateful that it was competent business, but as Linda Fabiani highlighted, it wasn't too long ago that the Scottish Parliament had to ask PQs just to find out the date when the GMC would be meeting. Now, things have clearly improved since then, but it is a reminder of how lacking relations have been at times between UK government ministers and Scotland's elected representatives. Now, I'm quite sure that MSPs across the chamber will have experienced difficulties, like I have, when trying to contact certain UK government departments on behalf of constituents, being informed that they would only deal with issues raised by MPs and not MSPs is certainly not in the best interests of a desperate constituent needing urgent assistance. But the need for mutual respect and good communications between central and devolved governments is important. But if we're serious about strengthening the role of parliaments, then I think we also need to see greater respect for the representatives elected to serve in those parliaments. I was interested, I mean, unfortunately Tavish Scott has left the chamber, but I was interested by Tavish Scott's comment about there being 11 former ministers in the chamber and questioning whether they were the best members to speak in this debate. Now, I'm not sure, not everybody's spoken yet, but I think we'll end up with probably 7 former ministers speaking in this debate. Now, I understand what he means by that argument and why he said that, but actually I'm going to disagree with him because I think perhaps former ministers are ideally placed to see both sides of the argument. I understand the arguments that we've made in the committee and agree with them about strengthening IGR and the important role of parliamentarians, but also I understand the difficulties and the requirements for governments to talk in a private space and have that room for discussion. I was certainly very interested to hear Ken Thompson's suggestion during the oral evidence session that it was the election of the SNP to government in 2007 which really brought into focus the need for improved IGR. Previously, of course, the Labour Party had been in power at both Holyrood and Westminster, and it appears that most discussions took place through party political channels rather than formal structures of intergovernmental relations. Times have indeed changed. Presiding Officer, my view is that there is undoubtedly a need for greater openness and transparency in IGR. The committee's evidence gathering suggests that much collaboration at the moment between administrations in the UK is carried out in an ad hoc and unstructured manner. This must be improved, although the balance does need to be struck between enhancing transparency on the one hand and still allowing space for free and frank private discussions between governments. Philip Rycroft, who represented the UK government in the committee's evidence session, accepted that there are advantages to the public gaining greater insight into the depth and range of discussions between the UK government and its devolved administrations. Parliament is a key part to play here in terms of improving transparency. It seems to me that enabling the public to have a greater understanding of the processes involved in IGR would also facilitate a better public understanding of the devolution settlement and what areas Holyrood has control over compared to Westminster. But in conclusion, Presiding Officer, the devolution package, as many others have said, is changing, though perhaps not to the extent that many of us had hoped. But when the people of Scotland voted no in last year's referendum, I believe that they voted to give the UK one last chance. If the Westminster Government is serious about making devolution work, then it needs to demonstrate that it has been treating its devolved legislators fairly. Better intergovernmental relations and indeed better scrutiny and public understanding of what goes on in these discussions is an important part of ensuring that devolution works not only for Scotland but also for the rest of the UK.
Many thanks. I now call Stuart Stevenson to be followed by Drew Smith.
Presiding officer, in this week of all weeks, we know that governments in these islands can and do work together. Tavish Scott referred to the First Minister's reference to her participating in COBRA, and indeed, when I was a minister, I did on it, certainly on one occasion, and I think more than one occasion. I still have the UK Transport Minister's mobile number in my mobile telephone. That's from when I was Transport Minister. So in practice, co-working is perfectly possible, and perhaps it's a little bit more common than is sometimes imagined. Sometimes the ministers are quite happy to bypass the civil servants to make things move just that little bit faster than others might want. Now, for our part, some co-decision making is already embedded in law. The former British Waterways Board was a cross-border authority which required both Scottish and UK ministers to sign off decisions that were required to be obeyed by ministers. Thus, I found myself, when I was responsible for canals, signing off a decision that related entirely to a transaction in Birmingham. The deal was I would do what the UK minister wanted to do in England and he would sign off anything we wanted in Scotland. But that co-decision-making crucially enabled us to protect canals in the public sector in Scotland when south of the border they wanted to travel in a fundamentally different way. So that shows it can be done. Similarly, appointments to the United Kingdom Climate Change Committee are jointly made by the Northern Irish, Welsh, Scottish and UK ministers and require unanimity on appointments. And on one occasion where there was a serious discussion on the matter, I found that I conducted the interviews with the candidates for a vacancy on that board, and thereafter we were able to achieve the unanimity that hadn't been there initially. So there already are some legislated areas, tiny, tiny, but the point is they show that the principle of accepting that legislating co-decision making is already something that we have. Practical experience shows it can be done. On finance, it would be particularly dangerous, I think, to imagine that there's no scope for legally embedding co-decision making, but equally, as others have said, there needs to be respect between individuals of different political parties, parliaments and governments, and carrying different objectives. Now, Baroness Goldie is correct in saying that one can't legislate for everything, but there are some things we could do differently on a unilateral basis that would deliver shared benefit. And there's been some reference to this already. The government that most promptly publishes details of intergovernmental meetings and the subjects discussed will create the opportunity for both parliaments who are interested in the subject to engage in their proper process of oversight. The laggard loses. And that's a message to governments both here in Edinburgh and in London. Neither government is perhaps as rapid as it could be in publishing that kind of information. And indeed, Belfast and Cardiff as well. Now, I note in the report that Professor McHarg said parliamentary scrutiny has been one of the areas in which the current system simply doesn't work. And I think that's got to be correct. A shared acceptance of the need to legislate over intergovernmental relations, I think, is vital. We can't simply leave it to memorandum of understanding. There are old arguments that flexibility delivers benefit, and yes, it does, but probably to governments, substantially less so, I suggest, to Parliament. Professor McEwen floats the idea of an additional Parliament committee on intergovernmental relations, and others have made other suggestions for new parliamentary committees here. But on the other hand, the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee's inquiry into our committee structures has almost universally attracted comments saying that we have too many committees
and that too many members are in too many committees. Some are actually on three committees. And who knows, the Standards and Procedures and Public Appointments Committee may bring forward the suggestion that members should only be a member of a single permanent committee. Note there's a little weasel word in there, so there might be a way out. Now, on negotiations between governments, I think the Scott work process, which is the standard that's used in most commercial negotiations, which is called limit, like in 10 must it, in other words, you go in with three lists, it's perfectly possible to publish in advance the must. In other words, here's, I go into the negotiations, here's what I need to get for my side. The like and intend, which are the dice that are played as the negotiation plays out, I suspect you can't publish. But I think there is more scope to publish the must intentions of various governments. Now, I'm one of those former ministers, and there's nothing more ex than an ex-minister, I have to say. But I think I didn't realise how much ministers had power until I became a minister, and I suspect I share that with others. But there are opportunities for Parliament to take more interest. There's a couple of things coming, Presiding Officer, in my concluding remarks here. Supermajorities are coming to us, and we're going to have to look at that. We've got the opportunity in this debate and beyond to think about doing things differently. Perhaps, just perhaps, ex-ministers, at least on this benches, untrammelled by the prospect of offending anyone and not being appointed to the House of Lords, perhaps we on this benches can be quite radical, where others might be more cautious. Presiding Officer.
Many thanks. I'm afraid I must now ask members to keep to their 6 minutes. Drew Smith, to be followed by Linda Fabiani.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, I think. I'm grateful to the Devolution Further Powers Committee for the opportunity to take part in this committee debate on parliamentary oversight of intergovernmental relations. An opportunity that surely makes the case again as to why Bruce Crawford is held in such esteem and affection by us all, not least by Annabel Goldie, even if Malcolm Chisholm felt it was perhaps more of a duty than a pleasure to take part in the debate today. I think those of us who are in opposition, and indeed those who serve on the government's backbenches, suffer or benefit, depending upon your point of view, of having proximity to power without the chance or the danger of actually wielding it. And when it comes to intergovernmental relations, the whole Parliament suffers a similar predicament, being not so much observers as outsiders to much of the process of ministerial negotiation and deliberation on which our constitutional arrangements make necessary, if not always exciting. And this is an area of policy making and development which, as Bruce Crawford said, has never been served by much in the way of transparency or accountability, and that is a problem that has been lamented for some time. Lord Smith of Kelvin did bring greater prominence to this with his timely call for improvements when he made personal recommendations based, I presume, on his experience of brokering the Smith Agreement. However, the committee's report makes clear that whilst our oversight of intergovernmental relations is perhaps particularly poor, it is not a challenge which is unique to our own devolution settlement, but is in fact a feature of similar relationships in many other jurisdictions around the world. And there are, of course, important reasons why we expect, and so far as we've ever consciously considered it, allowed ministers so much leeway to consider such matters largely in private. The matters, though, are more than administrative or diplomatic, because often it's through such channels that disputes of high importance are settled or indeed continued. And the committee's report, I believe, makes a cogent case as to why that needs to change. And I'm therefore minded to agree with them and I suppose, to share Lord Smith's frustrations. Like others, I was struck by two competing views or two interesting quotes contained in the committee report, which I held a lot of truth, but they've already been rehearsed, Presiding Officer, so I'll not repeat them again. But one of them was the Deputy First Minister talking about his experience of resolving things perhaps through conversation more than some of the other elements of the formal channel. And the other was Michael Keating, perhaps chiding the defence of politicians that things shouldn't always be discussed in public until they've been agreed. As I say, it was interesting to see in the report that there weren't any particular parts of the world doing this really well that we could use as examples, but there are examples of where it's perhaps done better than here. And I suppose the point I would also make, Presiding Officer, about our own situation is that despite last year's referendum and, in my view, pretty clear result, the Constitution in Scotland does remain a contested issue. And it's therefore difficult to put in place mechanisms and processes that can establish fairness to all parties, since there will always be a political driver that negates against solutions other than when issues become acute or when time is at its most pressing. And that, I think we have to accept, is simply a fact of Scottish politics. I haven't devoted any time so far to particularly talking about the fiscal framework, and I don't intend to, simply because I don't feel that I know enough about the nature of what is being discussed in order to make much of a contribution. But I certainly agree that it's important, and I'm certainly not unsympathetic to the arguments the Scottish Government have made around the fiscal framework, but that's perhaps a mark of the problem. I think also the resolution of issues around the trade union bill and legislative consent around the trade union bill may present a further example of when some of these relationships will be tested. And I would argue that the scrutiny of both parliaments might actually strengthen the hand of whichever government had the best arguments. These are all areas, Presiding Officer, where I think Parliament should be more jealous of the privileges and rights that it holds, and that should be true regardless of whether we're supporters of a particular government or not. I would also make the point that one of the consequences, and it's been made by others, one of the consequences of a post-Smith devolution settlement is that the clearer distinctions between reserved and devolved matters has been eroded in favour of quite specific competencies being moved around within what is essentially a shared policy competence. And Parliament should therefore be much more bold about the possibilities of joint scrutiny and indeed open to the possibility of co-decision within our framework. Now, Lord Smith, in highlighting all of these things, has also recently made the point that we need not just greater scrutiny of intergovernmental relations, but that this place also needs to do better at actual scrutiny of government actions in areas where they are accountable. And perhaps in response to Mr Stevenson's early point about the difficulty of disagreeing with colleagues, there are lessons for us all there too. Now, astonishingly, Presiding Officer, my time is almost at an end. So I suppose I would say in summary, the committee's report is a useful contribution to what is perhaps a dry but nonetheless important debate. And I certainly take the view that the recommendations which have been suggested are modest but welcome all the same. And I suspect it will be an issue that will be returned to in the next Parliament. And I'm sure we'll all, members of that Parliament will all benefit from the opportunity to debate it. It's been a cold and dark winter's afternoon. We perhaps haven't generated much heat, but I'm sure we have shed a little light on this issue this afternoon. Thank you very much, Presiding Officer.
Many thanks. I now call Linda Fabiani to be followed by Anne McTaggart.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. It's quite a difficult debate to be in because an awful lot has been said already, so I suppose if I can't be original, I'll try and be quite quick. looking at the stuff, I was struck by what people were saying about how things have been changing anyway. Stuart Maxwell mentioned some comments I had made during committee about how joint ministerial committees were used and how they were put together. And I think we can be a bit rough on ourselves here because we have to recognise that as a fairly new institution, a lot of these things are always going to evolve anyway. And that has been happening as the Parliament has been going on. And it's been happening between governments, but it's also been happening, I think, between parliaments. What I think we've been bad at is not recognising the good practice and giving it enough space to move on. And the reason I say that is because I was reminded through someone speaking about when I was convener of the Europe Committee a long, long time ago now, but we did set up regular meetings with the convener of the European Scrutiny Committee in the Commons and indeed in the Lords. And I thought it was a useful and very good system, but it fell into non-use because I was busy and they were busy and probably suffered from not making enough of an effort to keep these things going and gain the benefits from them. So if we are serious about setting up inter-parliamentary with respective governments and with each other, we have to recognise that if it's not in statute, it takes a lot of hard work and we have to work at it. and try and get mutual benefit from it. Back to what we were talking about at the committee. It certainly did come up in the Smith Commission, and I remember quite clearly it was Tavish Scott, and he referred to earlier, who felt very strongly on the Smith Commission that an awful lot of what we were trying to do couldn't be properly implemented unless we strengthened up the structures that we had in place for intergovernmental relations. So that was why Lord Smith felt strongly about it, put it in his report. That's why we ended up in the Devolution and Additional Powers Committee looking at it. And it was an interesting discussion because, again, we started from that point where we thought other people must be doing it a lot better than we were, and found out that, in fact, there's nowhere that we could find anywhere in the world that actually does it very well at all. So here we are again with the possibility of setting up something fairly new. Looking through the recommendations that we came up with, I'm pleased to see that the Scottish Government has already given quite a detailed response. That has not arrived yet from Westminster that I can see. I hope it does fairly soon, because it will be good to look at the different opinions coming from the respective governments about what we can actually achieve here. I was interested, there's the general ones about openness, transparency, etc. I was particularly interested in some of the other ones. People have covered the idea of establishing a specific committee or looking at the remit of committees that already exist.
Would the member take an intervention?
Yes, of course.
Stuart Maxwell.
Thanks for taking the intervention. I wondered whether Linda Fabiani wanted to expand on this point of discussion. We don't have come to a final view on whether it should be an additional committee or it should be done through existing committees, because clearly with the additional powers that are coming to this Parliament, an additional committee may on the face of it seem to be quite a difficult thing to establish, given all the extra powers that are coming to the Parliament. Quite difficult for the 129 members that are here to actually cope with that.
Linda Fabiani?
I suspect that the Deputy First Minister was very, very glad that he was able to respond to that with, "I recognise this as a matter for the Scottish Parliament to decide." And indeed it is, and it is an issue. Certainly in my role on the corporate body, we're very, very aware of the additional constraints and strains that will be put on this institution by the extra powers, and there's a lot of discussion to be had there about how we manage that. Stuart Stevenson touched on some of that. The recommendations that I particularly think are very, very important are numbers 7 and 9. Number 7 is the one where our committee affirms that we agree with the Deputy First Minister that it's absolutely essential that we have a fiscal framework that is robust, coherent and subject to parliamentary scrutiny before any legislative consent memorandum can be considered. I think that is very, very important. In fact, probably the most important thing that has come out of the recommendations in this committee. Absolutely essential that this Parliament knows exactly what is on offer from Westminster, because I believe very strongly that things haven't yet met the Smith Agreement, let alone the aspirations of the Scottish people. So let's make sure that that particular clause that has come from this recommendation from the Devolution Committee is taken extremely seriously by everyone in this Parliament.
Anne McTaggart, to be followed by Jim Eady.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I am pleased to have the opportunity to contribute to this afternoon's committee debate on devolution and parliamentary oversight of intergovernmental relations. And I would first like to congratulate the committee members for their report on the changing relationships between the UK and Scotland, and more specifically, the process of parliamentary scrutiny of intergovernmental relations. I would also like to thank the members of the committee for preparing such a comprehensive and thorough report on one of the most prominent issues for debate in Scotland today. As I am sure members across the chambers will agree, devolution is among the most common conversations that we have had here in the chamber over the last year. The relationship between Scottish Government and the UK Government has always been dynamic and open, and this trend has not changed over the last 15 years. Our intergovernmental relations are built on goodwill, positive communication and mutual trust, and they must continue to uphold this high standard moving forward. The report of the Devolution Further Powers Committee on Changing Relationships reveals several areas in which our relationships might be improved ahead of the recommendations of the Smith Committee. It is crucial for the productivity of this government that these areas be improved as our relationships with the UK government become more and more complex. An increase in shared and devolved powers must be met with an increase in the development of intergovernmental relations between Scotland and the UK. At present, most intergovernmental relations take place between ministers in an ad hoc meetings and in everyday communications between the ministers and officials. These types of informal relationships will always be important to the building of relations between Scotland and the UK governments. However, there are serious concerns that the formal relationship between our governments is not as strong as it should be. With the possibility of a new and stronger devolved powers for the Scottish Government, it is important now more than ever to work to strengthen and support the formal relationships and communications that we have with the UK Government. A strengthened system of formal intergovernment relations will necessitate closer communication, collaboration and compromise between our two governments, where each side will be held accountable for their actions. And in order to improve this partnership to be implemented, our processes for scrutiny must be enhanced. Our governments must work past our historical weaknesses in the scrutiny in order to improve and expand the effectiveness of our relationship. The current lack of transparency in the scrutiny is not sustainable for the future development of devolved Scottish powers. The only way that we can expect to improve is to promote robust, direct and meaningful discussion on concerns. The absence of a formal mechanism for raising such concerns only contributes to the lack of clear discussion and problem resolution. Moving forward, Presiding Officer, we must ensure that increased transparency and accountability are built into the fundamental underpinnings of the new devolved powers that Scotland will receive through the Smith Commission. With a strong formal framework to support communication and accountability, I believe that this will only be improved. While informal communications will remain a vital part of our partnership, this type of statutory framework provides a solid foundation on which to build with the UK Parliament. Further, in an effort to improve the process of scrutiny, the introduction of a formal permanent committee to examine the relationship between our two governments can only enhance our open and transparent communication. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, the devolution settlement proposed in the current Scotland Bill marks a significant step in Scotland's political journey. It is also very clear from the report and today's debate that there is a vital need for both governments to work together to create a more productive, robust, visible and transparent relationship. With an increasing complex relationship between the Scottish Government and the UK Government, it is essential to create the necessary mechanisms and structures to maintain clear, focused and transparent communication. I appreciate greatly the work of the Devolution Committee to address the changing dynamic of our intergovernmental relations and to develop our collaborations for the future.
Thank you, Jamidi.
Presiding Officer, I'm grateful for the opportunity to take part in this afternoon's debate. It is hard to envisage a debate on intergovernmental relations setting the heather on fire, except perhaps in some parallel universe inhabited by political anoraks, academics and, of course, Stuart Stevenson. However, in stating that, I intend no disrespect to Mr. Stevenson or to those who have been most closely involved in scrutinising this issue, because the members of the Devolution Further Powers Committee have done an excellent job in interrogating the existing arrangements and making very clear and cogent recommendations on specific ways in which the institutional infrastructure can be improved. And I should also like to place on record my appreciation of the work undertaken by the Centre for Constitutional Change, based at the University of Edinburgh, whose comparative analysis of intergovernmental relations in other jurisdictions has informed the work of the committee. The common theme throughout this debate from members across the chamber has been the recognition that the existing intergovernmental machinery requires overhaul. That is hardly surprising, given that the current arrangements date back to 1999, and of course we have had since then the 2012 Act, the Smith Commission, and the Scotland Bill, soon to be an Act. However, it is also worth acknowledging at the outset that there are whole swathes of policy making where there is no formal requirement for intergovernmental decision making. This was a point touched on by Stuart Maxwell. And although I would hope there would always be the opportunity to share good practice and to learn from each other across all of the four administrations, there is no formal requirement for intergovernmental decision making. There are non-comparable policies where an issue only exists, or largely only exists, in one part of the UK. Land reform in Scotland might be thought of as a good example of this. There are other issues where there is a high degree of policy autonomy, predating legislative devolution, but of course much more pronounced since the establishment of this Parliament. Areas such as local government, education, social care, and the operation of the National Health Service. While obviously here we need to recognise the continuing importance of health in reserved areas, such as immunisation and vaccination, the pricing of medicines, the regulation of medicines and medical devices, and the regulation of the health professions. And this is a good example of where the governments, the two governments in the UK, Scotland and UK, do talk to each other, and where there is a highly developed level of cooperation across the countries and the health systems of the UK. Having an institutional framework and machinery which allows decision-making involving the Scottish Government and the UK Government to be effective and timious is clearly necessary as part of the devolution settlement. However, where there are issues of disagreement or potential disagreement between the two governments, it is surely vital that we have arrangements which command the support of both parties, are based, as Anne McTaggart said, on mutual respect, and perhaps most crucially of all, which are capable of gaining the support and confidence of the public. That is certainly important if these arrangements are to be stable and durable for the medium to longer term. The principles as well as the practice underpinning good intergovernmental working have been touched on by a number of members this afternoon, and foremost among these has been the issue of transparency and the related issue of accountability. Professor Michael Keating put it well when he said, whenever there is intergovernmental working, things disappear into rather opaque arenas. That is really not necessary. It is a peculiarly British habit that we like to have our arguments in private before presenting things to the public, and governments will sometimes exploit that in order to stay away from the public gaze. That's a message we would all do well to take heed of. This applies as much to the governments, ministers and officials engaged in this process as much as it does to the parliaments and parliamentarians responsible for scrutinising these arrangements. We had, of course, the admission from Bruce Crawford that he was wrong, but only insofar as the importance of intergovernmental relations are concerned. And that led us into an important contribution with the insightful observation that intergovernmental relations are dominated by governments with limited scope for parliaments to scrutinise these arrangements and processes. Relationships must be accountable and subject to scrutiny was a clear message coming through from the committee. And it appears to me that accountability and transparency are in effect the opposite sides of the same coin, and it's here that we can see the tension between the two. The recommendation too of the committee that the principles of transparency and accountability should be placed in statute in the Scotland Bill, although the opportunity to do that may have passed, is in tension with the Scottish Government's view expressed in its response to the committee, and I quote, that it would require careful consideration and drafting to preserve private, internal and intergovernment space. So clearly that is a challenge for the governments and the parliaments as we move forward. Recommendation 3, that a new written agreement be taken forward, is one that we would all support. But of course, as Bruce Crawford rightly said, having written agreements, having memorandums of understanding, principles embodied into statute is not sufficient. What we need is the trust to underpin those arrangements. I would like to have commented on the other contributions, but time does not permit, Presiding Officer. In conclusion, we need to ensure that the rules of the game, as they apply to intergovernmental relations, are understood by all, are fit for purpose, to quote Lord Smith, are robust, visible and transparent. Whatever else we may disagree about in this chamber, we should all agree on that.
Thank you, Mr. Reedy. We move to the winding up speeches. I call Alex Johnson. 6 minutes, Mr. Johnson.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I welcome the opportunity to respond to this debate for my party. And I have to say that there have been some interesting comments made, not least of which was the one made by Malcolm Chisholm, who told us that he was participating in this debate largely out of a sense of duty. Well, when these exciting debates come along, duty is much a motivator for many of us. However, if we go back to the beginning of the debate, Bruce Crawford pointed out that it was Lord Smith himself in his comments after the Smith Commission reported that suggested that intergovernmental relations were going to be a very important part of everything we did going forward. And I think it was, I also agree with Bruce Crawford that it was something which perhaps on the Devolution and Further Powers Committee we did not take all that seriously at the outset, but very quickly came to realise that, yes, intergovernment relations were a critical part of what was going to happen as the new Scotland Bill progressed and relationships developed. However, it has to be said that our first attempt to find out what was going on in other parts of the world, how other parliaments dealt with executives that had to indulge in intergovernment relationships, the news wasn't good. It seems that across many countries in the world, these arrangements have evolved gradually over time, and that by and large they are arrangements that exist between executives but don't have very much in the way of parliamentary scrutiny to back them up. Therefore, having discovered that there was not much in that we could base our activities on, I think it's important that we understand that there is a desire within all the committee to ensure that if there is going to be parliamentary scrutiny of intergovernment relations here in the United Kingdom and on behalf of the Scottish Parliament, that we are starting from scratch, we need to get it right, and we cannot allow a system to evolve that excludes parliaments and leaves executives exclusively involved in this process. However, I will begin to argue with myself by saying that it is not easy, and the evidence suggested that it will not be easy. It won't be easy for a number of reasons, not least of which is I actually believe in the concept of executive authority. We as a parliament, once we're elected, appoint a government and ministers in that government to take decisions and take actions on our behalf. And it therefore is actually an important principle of my belief of that structure of government, that when we, even I, delegate Minister John Swinney to go and negotiate with the Westminster government on my behalf, that he has with him my executive authority to make agreements on my behalf, even though we may not have a great deal in common, some of the things we would like to achieve. Nevertheless, that principle is key. So it's important that whatever we do, that this Parliament, and I personally, am not on John Swinney's back, leaning over his shoulder at every step along the way. So that principle of executive authority is one that we must defend. Nevertheless, when you look at the changes that are on the way regarding taxation and welfare powers in particular, the fiscal framework will be vital. And that will be, I believe, as many have said, the most vital piece of intergovernment relation that we are likely to see in this Parliament or the next. For that reason, it's important that we do have recognisable structures, and the committee in its report have taken forward a few ideas for things that can be achieved. Simply knowing when meetings take place is important. If possible, knowing what is on the agenda is important. If we can get it into practice, having a minister come before a committee and discuss matters before negotiation takes place, so that the subject of that negotiation is slightly better understood by Parliament in advance. If these things are not possible, then post-agreement scrutiny must be our option. And of course, we can do both. But it is important that when we hold ministers to account, we hold ministers to account for agreements they've made on all our behalf. So the suggestions that have been put forward by the committee do give us the option to go in that direction. The idea that we should have a separate committee dealing with this matter is perhaps an ambitious proposal. Given the many responsibilities that this Parliament is about to acquire, the size of the Parliament and the nature of the existing committee structure, it may not be possible to have an individual committee for every purpose. But committee scrutiny is vital, and a committee of this Parliament must have the responsibility for that intergovernmental relations scrutiny. I suppose the final thing that needs to be said is that when we go forward with this, we must understand that there are other things that can happen to improve this structure. Now, we have a very asymmetric system of devolution in place, and symmetry within structure will never be possible. But I would like to see a similar system of scrutiny that existing at the other end. And if it is possible for Westminster to conduct scrutiny of their ministers in their relationship with other governments within the United Kingdom, then it is also possible that we, as a Parliament, through our committee structure, can strengthen our relationships with our committee, our parallel committee structure in Westminster. We already heard at some length from Linda Fabiani about the relationship that she has managed to achieve at times in the past. So I honestly believe that if we're going to make this work at its most effective, then we can finally perhaps square that circle by working hand in hand with Westminster committees and the Westminster Parliament on this scrutiny profile.
Mary Fee.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I start by thanking the Devolution and Further Powers Committee for bringing this debate to Chamber today and for the very well-written report which has been the focus of our discussion. And the report has given us the opportunity to assess where we stand as a Parliament in line with the four nations of the United Kingdom. And with the substantial new powers which are coming to the Scottish Parliament, we must ensure that we have the right structures in place to allow this chamber to properly scrutinise the bilateral and multilateral relationships with the UK Government and the devolved administrations. Yes, certainly.
Mr. Stevenson.
I know it may seem a small point, but I think we should not neglect to Guernsey, Jersey and the Isle of Man. I know in particular Guernsey has current serious issues with the power that the UK government has to veto any of its legislation on policy grounds. So I think there's a bigger picture even beyond the four that we often talk about.
Mary Fee.
Can I thank the member for that very useful and constructive intervention? As usual, Mr. Stevenson always comes up with something no one else has thought of, so thank you for that. Claire Baker, in her opening remarks, stated that the whole debate around intergovernmental relations should focus on openness and transparency, and rightly so. And Malcolm Chisholm made a number of points which were reflected by other members in this debate, including issues around weak intergovernmental relationships, the challenge of scrutiny, and the principles of transparency and accountability again. Anne McTaggart, in her contribution, pointed out that the possibility of new and stronger devolved powers for the Scottish Government, it's crucially important now, more than ever, that we work to strengthen and support the formal relationships and communications that we have with the UK Government. A strengthened system of formal intergovernmental relations will necessitate closer communication, collaboration and compromise between our two governments, where each side is held accountable. And, Presiding Officer, our country, our politics and our Parliament has changed dramatically since the re-establishment of the Scottish Parliament in 1999. And as the report states in the opening lines of the executive summary, the formal structures of intergovernmental relations between the UK government and the devolved administrations have undergone a process of evolution and expansion. And we can't be caught out in this new era in Scottish politics. And as with everything in politics, evolution is a necessity for change. So we must continue that evolution in line with the further expansion of the Parliament's powers. And with the process of agreeing a new memorandum of understanding, I commend the committee on commissioning the external research and evidence of the structures and levels of scrutiny of intergovernmental relations in other jurisdictions. And the committee itself acknowledges that there is no model or template from around the world that can be replicated here. Instead, we must learn from processes, procedures and principles of other jurisdictions and use them in negotiation of a new memorandum of understanding, one which also opens up the transparency of how our elected governments work with one another. External research also offers us five issues from a comparative assessment of practice and procedures in other jurisdictions, some of which I believe we should consider and others I do have some concerns around. Primarily, these focus once more on transparency and accountability. And the first issue around timing and access to information, which we should have no reason not to support. The second issue, a committee on intergovernmental relations, gives me cause for concern, as I believe, as the presiding officer and many other MSPs in this chamber do, that the committee system needs its own reform. We currently have too many committees that are overstretched and unable to carry out the scrutiny of the government and pre- and post-legislative scrutiny effectively. And the third issue, hearings and evidence sessions, does appeal to me to promote transparency. However, my concerns around who will carry out these sessions merge in with my concerns on a committee for IGR. And consent is the fourth issue, which suggests that there is a case for extending the Scottish Parliament's consent powers, given the increased significance of intergovernmental agreements over the block grant adjustments and the fiscal framework. This is one area that would need to be assessed further. The final issue, transparency and public engagement, and committing to report the outcome of intergovernmental meetings would open up the opportunity for MSPs, Welsh Assembly members and members of the Northern Ireland Assembly to debate such outcomes and further increased public awareness of what's going on behind the scenes. And this would clearly be preferential where joint ministerial committees are debating matters that would not reveal sensitive matters such as state intelligence. And finally, Presiding Officer, the Scottish Parliament must be able to effectively scrutinise intergovernmental relations. Whether the new memorandum of understanding results in relations being placed on a statutory footing, the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament must work more closely together, as the Deputy First Minister has said in evidence to the committee. Transparency and accountability are at the heart of our debate today. And as parliamentarians, we should welcome this report and embrace the evolution of intergovernmental relations with that in mind. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call on John Swinney, Deputy First Minister, 8 minutes.
Presiding Officer, I feel greatly strengthened by the debate today, particularly by the ringing endorsement from Alec Johnson of the fact that he is going to enthusiastically support everything I do in my discussions with the United Kingdom government. It was almost like the issuing, if one can imagine such a prospect, of Alec Johnson issuing a blank cheque. It generated a somewhat more giddy reaction from Baroness Goldie sitting at his side, who looked slightly more suspicious of the concept. But nonetheless, I will take Mr Johnson at his word and will make sure he doesn't criticise anything that I do at any stage in the future. On a serious note, can I pick up the point that Tavish Scott made about the, which Stuart Stevenson also echoed, about the point the First Minister made just a few hours ago in relation to the COBRA arrangements in which she was fully involved over the weekend, as Parliament would expect. And I think in my experience on a whole host of different issues over the years, when these emergency situations arise, the intergovernmental discussion is open, transparent, regular, frequent. So I think, my point is that it's totally possible to have good intergovernmental working when the need arises, when we all realise this is a very difficult situation, whether it's about the atrocities of Paris on Friday or whether it's about a weather incident or about whatever, we can actually find the mechanisms of good intergovernmental working. So I think we should take some heart from that, notwithstanding the criticisms that have quite clearly been made about the formality and the order of existing intergovernmental relationships. Malcolm Chisholm made the point that he thought it was easier for these arrangements to work when ministers from different administrations were from the same political party. I completely disagree with that point, totally. I remember vividly an interview given by one of my predecessors, one of my dear friends, Andy Kerr, who bemoaned the fact that he thought the SNP finance minister had got a better hearing from the Labour-run Treasury than he had ever managed to get. And equally, I have to say that my experience of dealing for the last 5 years up until the United Kingdom general election in May with a Liberal Democrat Chief Secretary to the Treasury, Danny Alexander, was a relationship driven by courtesy in both directions and very effective dealings on issues. Not that we managed to agree on everything, but I certainly couldn't complain about the courtesy and the nature of the dialogue that was implicit in that direct relationship. So I think I don't accept the point of view that it needs similarity of political backgrounds to agree good relationships. I'll give way to
the main point I was making on that was referring to the research, because I think the comment that you're referring to was based on the external research and about the way in which that worked. I think I pointed out that I quite often disagreed with colleagues as well.
Deputy First Minister.
I'll allow Mr Chisholm's remarks to stand, but I think the point for me is that I think it is, we have responsibilities as ministers, whatever our party political backgrounds, and our citizens expect us to be able to work our way through those politics to get good outcomes for citizens. Although I accept there will be genuine issues upon which we cannot reach agreement because of different interests. Mr MacDonald made the point that, and this is the first of a number of remarks I'd like to make about more the culture of intergovernmental relationships, that arrangements for intergovernmental relations can be put in place in the formality of documentation and rules and processes, but they need political will to make them work. And I agree with that. I think we can have all the rules we want, all the procedures, all the kind of notification arrangements, but if the political will isn't there to deal with courtesy and openness and to deal with things swiftly, then those arrangements will not work effectively, which in a sense brings me to Mr Scott's... of course, Scrofford.
Bruce Crawford.
In his speech today, Tavish Scott described the fiscal framework as the striking example of the type of agreement reached between governments, and the worth of that framework is fundamentally affected by the UK spending decisions. I hope I've got that about right, and I agree with Tavish. Given everything that's been said today about respect between governments and the need to share information with parliaments, just how much notice did we get of the proposed £2.5 billion of cuts to the UK for UK government departments so far, and the plans to cut the big lottery?
There are certainly... we have no... notification other than what's been in the media about spending decisions made at United Kingdom government level as they affect departmental arrangements. And of course, I'll await to hear what prior notice of the announcements come before the spending review on the 25th of November. But the point that I was coming on to make about Mr Scott's remarks was that Mr Scott made the point that there's a whole variety of different changes in the nature of governance within the United Kingdom, whether it's the Scottish Powers under the Smith Commission, or whether it's the Northern Powerhouse, or whether it's the West Country, Cornwall, or wherever it happens to be. And to me, that will require a change in political culture for all of these arrangements to work properly. Because if we operate in a system which Mr Gibson highlighted slightly more bluntly than I would ever manage to say, where people are treated as equals, not as rulers and ruled, we get somewhere close to realising that the political culture has to fundamentally change, where there might actually be a remote possibility that something that I say as the Scottish Finance Minister might have more validity than what the Treasury happens to believe on a particular issue. Heaven forfend if that was ever to come to pass. But the point I'm making is that when we have these different and distinctive changes in political accountability and relationships, political culture needs to change to take account of that. And that requires some of the attitudes whereby UK departments, UK government may think, well, we take the decision, that is what others have to get on with. That attitude has to change if we are to make progress on intergovernmental relationships. Finally, Presiding Officer, let me just close on the issues about the fiscal framework, which were referred to by Drew Smith and by Tavish Scott and by others in the debate, Linda Fabiani and others. I have endeavoured to keep Parliament as fully informed as I can, notwithstanding a formal negotiation is underway about the issues that are at stake within the fiscal framework. I've done that through my appearance at the Finance Committee, through Devolution and Further Powers Committee, and my participation in the Finance Committee debate on the subject back on the 7th of October. And I commit myself once again to addressing any issues that Parliament wishes to address with me about the nature of the progress on the fiscal framework. The discussions are ongoing. I have mapped out to Parliament the issues that I think are at stake in that fiscal framework. Obviously, I cannot map out the conclusions that have been reached because those conclusions have not been reached. So I assure Parliament, and I respectfully say to Parliament, that if it wishes me to provide further information, commentary or participate in further scrutiny and consideration of the issues around the fiscal framework, then I will of course fulfil my duty to Parliament to do exactly that. I'd close, Presiding Officer, with this observation that we need to make sure that we have in place effective intergovernmental relationships to ensure that the complex landscape of governance in the United Kingdom can operate effectively on behalf of the citizens of this country. That will not just be by a set of rules, it will be by a change in the culture of the interaction between different administrations, where there is an atmosphere of mutual respect and we are able to be treated, as Mr. Gibson said, as equals in that process of discussion and dialogue.
Thank you. Can I now call on Duncan McNeill to wind up the debate on behalf of the Devolution Further Powers Committee at 5 o'clock, Mr. McNeill?
Yes, thank you, Presiding Officer. whether we're here today, as Tavish Scott and I are, at least, and others, I'm sure, are from genuine interest in this issue and debate, or from a sense of duty or merely conscripts, I don't know, but my only regret in this cold chamber here today, Presiding Officer, we haven't managed to generate more heat because it's freezing in here, as somebody who's sat here all afternoon. So if we know anybody that's got their hands on that heating knob, it shouldn't just be left to parliamentarians to inject.
I'm freezing too. I'll report it.
Inject heat into the debate. But I think it has been a useful debate. I think it's a debate, as Malcolm Chisholm says, we need to get more interested in and take more seriously. I think we have established that from Stuart Stevenson and others, and others that have just joined us maybe, that this is nothing new. There's a lot of experience in this chamber, and people have communicated across governments and across parliaments from its inception, whether that has been done well or not. And I think Tavish Scott raised that question, that while we recognise that lots of communication takes place on a day-to-day basis, sometimes in technical matters, as Drew Smith says, or indeed at a point of crisis or an argument, that's all very well. But things, as Tavish Scott says, are not all fine. There's much more that we can do. I think we have also, it's been useful in the debate to recognise, and I saw no dissent about the direction of travel and moving from devolved areas into shared powers, which is going to be much more challenging for us as governments, and indeed Parliament about how we interact together, how we have got, how we ensure that the capacity that we do have in this chamber is used well to provide scrutiny, examine many of these issues. And also, I think the point was made by Rob Gibson and Jamidi and maybe some others about that this may be presented as a dry debate, but it has an effect. It has an effect on what we're doing and how it impacts on people, whether it be the fishing community, as mentioned by Rob Gibson, or regulation on our health service. Or whatever. If we do that better, then we'll all be better for it. As I said, you know, I think we're working in that context. Many members have recognised that we are shifting quite clearly through the Scotland Bill, and of course, it's important that we make this practical and see it as a practical level. To me, there is a reduced chance of being able to use the powers that come from Smith effectively, particularly on welfare, without those two governments working well. That's the reality. If we want to use some of these powers to affect a practical change and improvement on the people we represent, then we have a responsibility to get that right. It's not just about the politics there, it's about improving lives for people. And as a consequence, if you accept that proposition that if we're going to change people's lives, then it's incumbent on us to ensure that there are good intergovernmental structures in place. And it's incumbent on this Parliament to ensure that we are content with the structure and are informed, not merely observers, as Drew Smith said, and consulted about the deals that the two governments do in that space. Like others, I recognise the challenges that will lie ahead for this institution. I've mentioned them on being able to successfully scrutinise government policy making in the future. It's my contention that we'll also have to recognise that this issue is not, of course, as others have said, unique to this place. As the convener noted at the outset, the external research committee, commissioned by the committee on this subject, found that intergovernmental relations almost anywhere in the world we looked at are dominated by the executive, by the governments. Not so surprising, given that we're looking at intergovernment relations. What is unusual here, though, in the United Kingdom, that legislators in virtually all of the countries that we looked at have a more powerful scrutiny role in relation to these issues than any legislator in these islands. Professor Michael Keating's words have been invoked a number of times today when he was looking at this, and he said to the committee, "It is a peculiar British habit that we like to have our arguments in private before presenting things to the public. And governments will sometimes exploit that in order to stay away from the public gaze. We have a very poor parliamentary scrutiny of intergovernmental relations." Now, probably we could all agree that that's a British trait that we could well do without, and we can do more. It certainly chimes with my experience in seeking to get answers on these issues. Only in the last few days, we have witnessed a debate taking place on the fiscal framework that sits alongside the Scotland Bill. And Mr Swinney has said that he won't do a deal on the bill without a fair and sustainable framework. And I would be tempted to agree with him. But how do I know that I can? How do I know what's in the framework, or even what he is currently discussing with the Treasury? I want to emphasise clearly at this point that I'm not being critical of the current government remarks. I think this culture, as he referred to earlier, applies regardless of the political complexion of any particular government, and that happens to happens to be in power at any given point. Yes, give way.
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm grateful to Mr McNeill for giving way. What I've tried to do is to set out for Parliament, particularly in the fiscal framework debate on the 7th of October, the issues that are at stake within the discussions with the United Kingdom Government. I would, of course, as I've said in my closing remarks, be perfectly happy to engage further with Parliament if Parliament wishes me to do so on those questions.
Yes. Thank you.
And the committee appreciates you doing what you have done within the constraints that you're presented with. But we do come back to the committee's stronger view than we recommended that the principles of transparency and accountability should be placed in statute in the Scotland Bill as underpinning principles governing relationships in this area. But as Alec Johnson pointed out, there is a balance to be struck between allowing governments the space to negotiate and reach agreement whilst also being accountable, and we accept that, and there is clearly an absence, as referred to some others, that since 1999 the accountability strand of that relationship has been missing. In my view, the convener stated in the opening of the debate, it is the responsibility of the Scottish Parliament and ourselves as parliamentarians to ensure that our scrutiny practices are as effective as possible in this area. And I go back to the issue of duty, not merely about why we were here. I think in the context of the founding principles of the Scottish Parliament that we look at how we develop intergovernmental relationships and cross-party parliamentary relationships and avoid the British trait of secrecy and hiding what we need to know. The key principle shaping the Scottish Parliament, of course, it doesn't do us any harm to remind ourselves at this point, are accessibility, open, responsive, to encourage participation, with a Scottish Government accountable to the Parliament, accountable to the Scottish people, sharing power between the legislators and the Scottish Government. And it's in that context that we need to ensure that we get intergovernmental relationships that are within that context and work across Parliaments to ensure that Parliaments have the right to scrutinise government in a new and changing environment. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr McNeill. That concludes the Devolution for the Powers Committee debate on changed relationships, parliamentary scrutiny of intergovernmental relations. We now move to the next item of business, which is decision time. There are two questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first question is at motion number 14848. In the name of Nicola Sturgeon, on a motion of condolence, Paris, 13 November 2015, be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to. The next question is at motion number 14820, in the name of Bruce Crawford, on change in relationships, parliamentary scrutiny of intergovernmental relations, be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to. That concludes decision time. We are now moved to members' business. Members who are leaving the chamber should do so quickly and quietly.